So, what we had studied in our previous session, we have defined few statements or few definitions. That is, we have known what is finite set. We have defined countable sets and uncountable sets. Apart from that, we have defined what are denumerable sets, and we have also discussed a few of the theorems related to it. So, in this session also, again, we are going to study few of the theorems related to the same topic. That is, we are going to see some more theorems. Theorem one is that we need to do a finite set is not equivalent to any of its proper subsets. What is the theorem given? A finite set is not equivalent to any of its proper subsets. So what we are supposed to prove? If a finite set, that is a given finite set, it is not equivalent to any of its proper subset. See, we get two conditions to prove here. When the set, let us consider that finite set as A. That is, once we consider if A, what happens if A is empty, and what happens if A is not empty. Let us start proving this theorem. Proof of the theorem. As I said, what we are going to consider first, let A be a finite set. Let A be a finite set. When we are going to say A is finite, when either it is empty, right? We have already defined the definition of this finite set. So we are going to consider to prove this theorem. Now we will consider two conditions. What happens if A is empty? If A is empty, then A has no proper subsets at all. Then what we are going to do? If A is an empty set, then what is going to happen? Then A have no proper subset, and as I said, if it is going to be empty, it is not going to have any proper subset. And what is going to happen? And we don't have anything to prove. If it is not having any proper subset itself, then we have now things to prove. That is, and we have nothing to prove. Now, what happens if A is not equal to an empty set? If A is not equal to an empty set, then what we are going to do? If A is not equal to empty set, then A has proper subset. See, then A will be equivalent to nm for some m belongs to n. See, if it is not empty, then A is equivalent to nm for some m belongs to n. It is the set of natural numbers. That is, if A is not an empty set, then what we are going to say? There exists, it has some elements, right, m. Then A will be equivalent to nm for some m belongs to n. If so, let B be a proper subset of A. Then what we are going to say? Let B be a proper subset of A, and let us consider that B has k elements, and B has k elements. Then what is going to happen? Then B is going to be equivalent to nk. Then what is going to happen? Then B is equivalent to nk elements, where k should be missed, where k should be less than m. Then what is going to happen? Then B is going to be equivalent to nk. See, what has happened? A and B, they do not have same number of elements. For to be equivalent, they should have same number of elements, right? B has k elements where k is less than m. Therefore, what we are going to say? B, A and B do not have same number of elements, since A and B do not have same number of elements. Now, once they don't have same number of elements, what we are going to say? Then A cannot be equivalent to B. A cannot be equivalent to B. Very simple thing. Just we have considered A be the finite set. Then to prove that it is not equivalent, we have two conditions. If A is empty and A is not empty. If A is empty, then there is nothing to prove for us. What happens if A is not empty? We said that A is equivalent to nm, where m belongs to some natural numbers. Then what we considered? Then we considered that let B be a proper subset of A. So B has k elements where k is less than m, that is B has elements less than A. Then we say then B is equivalent to nk, and since A and B do not have same number of elements, A cannot be equivalent to B. Hence we proved that a finite set is not equivalent to any of its proper subset. I hope you all have followed this theorem. Now let us move to one more theorem. Very simple theorem it is. Now let us move to the next theorem. What is the next theorem given? The set of real numbers X theorem. The set of real numbers X such that X such that X is greater than or equal to 0 and less than or equals to 1 is not countable. Is not countable. That is, it is a closed interval. That fact, how we can define it in one more way? Or we can say that the class interval 0, 1 is not countable. The class interval 0, 1 is not countable. Let us prove this theorem. See, what we shall do is we are going to prove this theorem by the contradictory method. That let us assume that the class interval 0, 1 is countable. We shall prove this theorem by the contradictory method. That is, let us assume that the class interval 0, 1 is countable. See, obviously it is not countable. We know it. Why? Because we just say that yes, 0, 1, they are just two numbers. Once after 0, 1 is going to come. But no, that is not the case. We are going to get 0, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, so on up to 0.9. Then you feel that okay, only 0.9, only these many numbers are there. But again, that will not be a case. In between 0 and 0.1, we will be having 0.01, 0.02. And that is why in those sub intervals, again, we are going to have many numbers. That is why we need to prove that the closed or the class interval 0, 1 is not countable, or the class interval 0, 1 is uncountable. So we shall prove it by contradictory method. What they have given? Let us assume that the class interval 0, 1 is countable. If it is countable, it implies either 0, 1 it should be finite or denumerable. To be countable, we have already solved one theorem. That is, to be countable, it should be either finite or denumerable. This implies, what does this implies? This implies either 0, 1 is finite or 0, 1 should be denumerable. Denumerable. These are the two possibilities. That is, either 0, 1 is finite or 0, 1 is denumerable. If so, what we are going to do? Since every interval is an finite set, 0, 1 is denumerable. Since, what is going to write? Since every interval, it might be any interval, since every interval is an, it is infinite set, so 0, 1 is denumerable. Since it is going to be infinite, what we consider 0, 1 is going to be denumerable. This implies there is an enumeration. This implies we can extend it. This implies there is an enumeration. What kind of enumeration do we have? There is an enumeration, that is x1, x2, x3, so on. It goes on. This is infinite of real numbers in 0, 1 of real numbers in 0, 1. What kind of enumeration we have? x1, x2, x3, so on, of real numbers in between 0, 1. So what is going to happen if we have this enumeration? We can expand each xi, right? We are going to expand each xi, means I might be 1, 2, 3, 4, so on. So we are going to on expanding each xi in the form of an infinite decimal, expanding each xi in the form of decimal numbers. How we are going to write it in the form of decimal numbers? For example, x1 is equals to, we will write x1 is equals to 0.a11, a12, a13. This goes on like this, right? a11, a12, a13, a14, so on up to a1n. x2 can be written as what? 0.a21, a22, a23, and this goes on still continuing, so on, a2n and so on, continuing like this. If we are going to consider it for xn, it's going to be xn is equals to 0.an1, an2, so on up to ann, and so on. Since it is infinite, we are expanding this each xi in the form of what? In the form of infinite decimal. In the form of infinite decimal. So we expressed it in the form of an infinite decimal, where each aij, this is going to belong for 0.1, 2, 3, 4, so on up to 9, right? So is going to belong 0.1, 2, 3, 4, so on up to 9. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Aij, they are the numbers, right? So consider the number b with decimal representation. Now we are going to consider another number b with some decimal representation. Consider the number b with decimal representation. How we are going to represent it? B is equals to 0.B11, B12, 0.B1, B2, B3, so on up to BN. It is also going to be the decimal representation, where B1 is any integer from 1 to 8 such that B1 is not equals to A11, where B1 is, it might be any integer, it might be any number, any integer between 1 to 8 such that B1 is not equals to A11. What is the condition given? B1 is not equals to A11. The same way B2 is any integer. B2 is any integer between 1 to 8, again such that B2, this is not going to be equal to A22. Continuing like this for n numbers, keep on continuing like this for n numbers, then what we are going to get? Bn is any integer from 1 to 8. Bn is any integer from 1 to 8 such that Bn is not equals to ann. So we just written that we have considered our number B with decimal representation, where B1, B2, so on, they are not equal to A1, A2 or A11, A22, so on up to ANN. Now what happens? Clearly B belongs to 0,1 and B is not equals to XN. What is going to happen? Clearly B belongs to 0,1. But what has happened? But B is not equals to xn for all n. What happened? B is not equals to xn for all n. Since the decimal expansion has what happened? The decimal representation of B is different from the decimal representation of xn. Decimal representation of B is different from the decimal representation of xn. Since it is different, we arrive at a contradiction. What we say? Decimal representation of B is what it is? It is different from the decimal representation of xn. So we arrive at a decision that it is contradictory. So we arrive at contradiction, and hence what is going to happen? Therefore we say that 0,1 is not countable. Therefore 0,1 is not countable. I hope you all are following. To prove it as not countable, we proved it through a contradictory method. What we first considered? Let this class interval 0,1 be countable. So, but we know that every class interval is infinite, and hence what we decided? We considered that it is, since the set is infinite, it is denumerable. So if it is denumerable, we consider its enumeration. How we have defined the real numbers x1, x2, x3, so on of real numbers in 0,1. Now what we have done this, we have expanded each xi, means we have represented x1 as in the form of infinite decimal numbers, that is 0.A11, 0.A12, so on up to 0.A1n, and so on. Like that we defined it up to n terms. And then where what is going to happen, where each a I j belongs to these number between 0.123 so on up to 9. So what we said, consider the numbers b with decimal representation. We again considered one number b whose decimal representation is b is equals to 0.b1b2b3 so on up to bn. Then for b1 there exists any number between 1 to 8 such that b1 will not be equal to a11. The same way b2, that will be not equals to a22, so on up to bn, that will be not equals to ann. By seeing this clearly, what we got to know, b belongs to 0, 1, but b is not equivalent to xn for all n, since decimal representation of b, that is different from decimal representation of xn. We arrived at a contradiction, and therefore we said that the class interval 0, 1 is not countable. I hope you all have followed this theorem. Now let us move to the next theorem. What is the next theorem given? The set of real numbers is not countable. We need to prove the theorem that the set of real numbers is not countable. See, very simple thing, we need to prove that the set of real numbers is not countable. But we know that every subset of a countable set is countable. What we are going to write first? We know that every subset of a countable set is going to be what? Is countable. How we are going to represent real numbers? It is represented by R, right? Then if R were countable, then 0, 1, which we have just proved in the previous theorem, which is a subset of R, must also be countable, right? Just we have proved in our previous theorem that 0, 1 is uncountable. So if R is countable, then the class interval 0, 1 should also be countable, no? That is what we are going to write here. If R were countable, then the class interval 0, 1, then 0, 1 would be what? Which is a subset of R, 0, 1, which is a subset of R, it should also be countable. Of R must be what? Must be countable, right? But in the just previous theorem we have proved that it is uncountable. But the unit interval 0, 1 is not countable. But what we know? But this unit interval, how it is? 0, 1 is not countable. Hence, what is going to happen? Therefore, R is uncountable. Hence, R is not countable. The set of real numbers is not countable. What we considered, the subset of a countable set should be countable. But what we have studied, the class interval 0, 1, which is the subset of real numbers, that is not countable. Since it is not countable, the real numbers or the set of real numbers is not going to be countable. Very small and simple theorem. Now let us move to the another theorem. What is the theorem given? Every infinite set is equivalent to a proper subset of itself, what they have said, every infinite set, it is going to be equivalent to a proper subset of itself. To be equivalent, we already have studied what are equivalent sets, right? So what they have given, for every infinite set is going to be equivalent to its proper subset of itself. Let us consider, let A be an infinite set. If it is infinite, then what we are going to say? Since every set contains a denumerable set, right? Every infinite set. Contains denumerable subset. Every infinite set, it is going to contain denumerable subset. So let us consider what? Let B is equals to A1, A2, A3, so on. Let this be the subset. B1, B2, B3, so on, be a denumerable subset of A. That is, subset of A. Now what we considered, B is equals to A1, A2, A3, so on, be a denumerable subset of A. So what is going to happen? Then let C is equals to A minus B. Then what is going to happen? Then A will be equal to B union C, right? If we have considered, let C be A minus B, then A is equals to B union C. Now what we are going to consider again, let P is equals to A minus A1 be a proper subset of A. What we are going to consider next, let P is equals to A minus A1. Let this be a proper subset. What we considered, let P is equals to A minus A1 be a proper subset of A. Now consider the mapping. Consider the mapping function, or consider a mapping F from A to P. Consider a mapping. How is this mapping? This is going to be a function from F from A to P. What we considered a mapping F from A to P, defined by F of A. And how we are going to define this mapping? We are going to define it as F of AI. This will be equals to AI plus 1, defined by defined by f of ai, this will be equals to ai plus 1 for ai that is going to belong for the set B. We defined the function f from a to p in such a way that f of ai will be equal to ai plus 1 for ai belongs to B, and f of a is equals to a for a belongs to C, and f of a is equals to a for a belongs to C. Then this is going to be 1 1 and on to, right? Then f is 1 1 and on to. Then f is 1 1 and on to. Now what happens if the function f is 1 1 and on to? So we all know that if f is going to be 1 1 and on to, then what is going to happen? Then a is going to be equivalent to p. Yes, a is going to be equivalent to p. Hence we proved that every infinite set is equivalent to a proper subset of itself. To prove it, what we consider? Very simple steps. A B infinite set. If it is infinite set, it is going to have denumerable subsets. So how we define B is equals to a1, a2, a3, so on, be the denumerable subset of A. So if it is so, we are going to have C such that it will be equal to A minus B, then A is equals to B union C. If it is so, what we are going to get? We define P a proper subset of A, considering a mapping from function F to A to P in such a way that f of a1 will be equal to a1 plus I. Then what is going to happen if it is so and f of a will be equal to a, then for all a belongs to C, what is going to happen? Then f is 1 1 and on to. If it is 1 1 and on to, then a is going to be equivalent to P. Hence we proved that every infinite set is equivalent to a proper subset of itself. I hope you all have followed this theorem. Let us consider one more theorem. What is the theorem given? It is given that the set n cross n is countable. The set n cross n is countable. How we are going to prove this theorem? See, consider the sets. We are going to consider the sets A1 is equals to, how it will be? 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, so on. Again, A2 will be equal to 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, so on. They have said n cross n, right? So find a order pair, that is a1, a2, a3, so on up to, we are going to consider it up to what? an is equals to n, 1, n, 2, so on, n, 3, and so on, and this goes on further, n cross n. Clearly n cross n, that is going to be what? It is going to be the union of an. By seeing all this, what we'll come to know? We'll come to know that clearly n cross n, that is equals to union of an, where n belongs to this capital N. What happened? This is clearly union of an, where n belongs to n. Also the function f defined from an to n is, how we can define? Also the function also the function f from an to n is defined by, how we can define it? That is going to be defined by what? It can be defined as f of n comma I will be equal to I is 1 1, and on to is 1 1, and on to. So what has happened? We said f of n comma I is equals to I is 1 1, and on to. Therefore an is denumerable. If it is 1 1 and on to, therefore we say that an is denumerable. If an is denumerable, n cross n is denumerable. What I said, if an is denumerable, then n cross n is denumerable. And what is going to happen is a denumerable collection of denumerable sets, it is denumerable and hence countable. See what happened, n cross n is denumerable collection of, since n cross n is denumerable collection of what? Collection of denumerable sets. Collection of denumerable sets. If it is denumerable collection of denumerable sets, therefore what it is going to happen? It is going to be denumerable and hence countable. It is denumerable and hence what is going to happen? And hence countable. So what we proved? The set of n cross n is countable. We considered the sets a1, a2, so on up to an. It means n cross n will be equal to union of an, where n belongs to this capital N. We defined a function f from an to n in such a way that f of n comma I is equals to I. Then it is clearly 1 1 and on to, and that is why what happened, if it is 1 1 and on to, an is denumerable. What we know, since n cross n is denumerable collection of denumerable sets, therefore it is going to be denumerable and hence countable. So we proved this theorem. So students, I hope you all have followed these. Today's almost theorems are very simple theorems, and I hope you all have followed these simple theorems. Keep studying, stay safe. Thank you.